Hey everybody, Fat Man here, and today we are talking about the greatest sitcom of all time. Comedy and media, in all ways we consume such, are obviously subjective. I can't definitively call something the greatest of all time, no matter how I feel about it, because somebody out there might disagree. However, it is my channel and my video, so you can all suck it. Malcolm in the Middle is the best sitcom of all time.
Woo!
There's your reveal. What was that? What you were expecting?
No, I was expecting King of Queens or at most Seinfeld.
Nope, it is Malcolm.
All right.
Strictly speaking, in relation to live action sitcoms, the situational comedy isn't something new, and it's a formula that can grow tired and stale very quickly. Many people look back to the sitcom golden age for their favorites, anything from classics like I Love Lucy, The Honeymooners, and The Dick Van Dyke Show, to the popular 80s or 90s renaissance with shows like Family Matters, Seinfeld, and Friends. Hell, even going more modern, viewers are madly in love with newer material such as The Big Bang Theory, The Office, and It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia. I've seen a lot of sitcoms. I've seen some of the worst, and I've reveled in some of the best. I'm a huge fan of Friends, That 70s Show, Everybody Hates Chris, and Full House, to name a few. But for my money, nothing is or will ever be as good as Malcolm in the Middle. I've never related this much to a sitcom, and I know it's going to sound cheesy, but there were so many points in Malcolm where I felt like episodes were being scripted based upon my life. I'm the oldest of five, and some of my favorite memories are of all of us gathering around to watch Malcolm in the Middle together, coming to the realization that what was going on that week's show was something that we had already done, or something we can now replicate. We were so infatuated with the series that at one point my dad banned Malcolm in the Middle from his household, claiming it to be a terrible influence on us. Series creator Linwood Boomer sells the family dynamic better than anything I've ever seen attempt to do so, loosely basing the characters on his real-life, no-nonsense mother and brothers. There are no rainbows and hugs going around, episodes don't end with an apology for that week's hijinks, not everybody is getting along, and there's not really a moral or a lesson, and when there is, it's a real one. One of my all-time favorites come from the season 1 episode Malcolm Babysits, when Malcolm asks what his job is gonna pay and Lois answers with this: "I'll tell you what they're going to pay you. They're going to pay you what all jobs pay. Less than you're worth, but just enough to keep you crawling back for more." I also feel that the series is so much smarter than people give it credit for. Malcolm in the Middle created something truly unique, and it's in no small part thanks to this powerhouse of a cast. Bryan Cranston as Hal and Jane Kaczmarek as Lois are hands down my favorite TV couple of all time. They sell this so well that growing up, I thought they were actually married. I don't really say this about many actors, but these two were made for this role. So much so that when they reprised these roles for a parody ending to Breaking Bad, they did so unbelievably effortlessly that it didn't even feel like several years had passed since they last portrayed these characters. Frankie Muniz, Justin Burfield, Eric Per Sullivan, and Christopher Kennedy Masterson all absolutely blow me away as Malcolm, Reese, Dewey, and Francis, respectively. They all play off of each other so well that I would have thought they actually grew up around each other. And the younger three really give the middle finger to all the lame cliches surrounding child actors. At most points of the series, these kids are laying it down better than the adults in the room. Not only did Malcolm in the Middle have an incredible talent in its main cast, but it ditched the dopey-ass laugh track in favor of mood-setting music and the iconic fourth wall breaks that Malcolm does when he speaks to the camera directly. Pair that with the way that the incidental music was lovingly crafted for each scene, shout out to They Might Be Giants, as well as the iconic door slam and screen wipes and the single camera setup, oh my god! Right out of the gate, the show is unconventional and bizarre. Malcolm in the Middle takes all of these risks that no other sitcoms at the time were taking, and it absolutely dominates with them. The effort shines through 1000%. A big, big, big thank you to the people who worked behind the camera on Malcolm in the Middle as well. They were as equally important as the cast at making this show an all-time great. The writing, the dialogue, the family dynamic, the auditory and camera techniques. Malcolm in the Middle hits the bullseye in every single one of these areas, and I honest to God can't think of a major thing where the series lacks in. Even the basic setup of a dysfunctional household based around a lower middle class family is nothing new. But thanks to the care and effort put forth by this team, I truly think that Malcolm in the Middle is going to stand the test of time. I can't remember when exactly I started watching this show, but I do remember seeing a teaser trailer advertising a brand new episode for the season 4 classic If Boys Were Girls. and that episode premiered in February 2003.
Christ, you really did research.
Yes, I do. That puts me at about 8 years old, and I have literally not stopped watching since.
Stop it. Get some help.
I revisit Malcolm in the Middle either in part or in full once a year. I am not kidding. I don't really have too much time anymore to sit down and watch TV, but on the rare occasions where I do get a minute and I'm channel flipping, if Malcolm in the Middle is on for whatever reason, I will always stop. Premiering in January of 2000 and running for 7 seasons and 151 episodes before wrapping in May of 2006, Malcolm in the Middle is a true legend in this industry and a perfect example of something that just gets better every time you watch it. If I haven't convinced you by this point, odds are it's not going to happen, but for the rest of you who have actual taste, come with me and relive this forever endearing work of art. I can't help but use this word in relation to this show, but season one is iconic. You can't throw a rock without hitting an absolute banger, and this becomes evident in the first few minutes of the pilot episode.
Mom's tits.
They're just boobs, lady. The family dynamic is in full swing, and we are keyed in very quickly that this family isn't going to be like any other one on TV. The chemistry between the brothers and the parents is absolutely unreal, both when examined together and apart. Hal and Lois are completely dysfunctional, but the love between them can't be matched. Reese, Malcolm, and Dewey are at constant war with each other, but are a united front when anything else threatens them. Francis, being a 12-hour drive away at Marlin Academy Military School, somehow manages to still be the biggest bane in Lois's existence. The supporting cast rolls out with the introduction of Craig Lamar Traylor as Stevie, who is absolutely hilarious for the entire run of this series. Daniel Von Bargen as Commandant Spengler has such a huge presence, and the parallels drawn between him and Lois in relation to Francis is always so much fun to watch. Every character, from the other cadets at Marlin Academy to the rest of the kids in Malcolm's Crowboy class, do such a fantastic job at breathing life into these roles, especially when they're almost never the main focus. Kareem Prince as Cadet Stanley was a great foil to Francis, and I wish he would have stayed on the show a little longer, though Eric Neninger as Cadet Eric is a pretty great replacement as well. I am so sorry for butchering any of the names I'm butchering in this. David Anthony Higgins as Craig is a standout highlight in a series full of highlights. I don't think this actor is capable of turning in a bad performance. And again, the first season of Malcolm in the Middle is loaded with classics. Shame, Smunday, Crowboyne Picnic, Roller Skates, and Red Dress are all perfect examples of a starting point if you're new to this franchise. The slapstick and visual gags are top-notch. The jokes are punchy and memorable, and I think there really is something to be said about the underrated delivery of the jokes as a whole across Malcolm in the Middle. Even as an adult, a few of these lines fly over my head, and not because I don't understand them, but because the delivery is so nonchalant that sometimes it takes me a minute to realize that this show just made a hilarious joke. The dedication by the cast here is to be applauded, but no more so than Bryan Cranston, especially in this first season. He is putting in work, man. In The Bots and the Bees, he actually wore a suit with 10,000 live bees on it and somehow only managed to get stung one time. For Roller Skates, he actually learned how to skate and performed 90% of his stunts for that episode. Breaking Bad wasn't his breakout point, people. This man was always magic. Funnily enough, Aaron Paul tried to audition for the role of Francis. How crazy would that have been? Gary Anthony Williams as Abe Carnarvon, Stevie's father, is another magnificent standout in the series. Williams is just one of those actors that doesn't even necessarily need to be saying something funny and he'll still get a laugh. He's a great presence, and this role as the soft-spoken gentle giant absolutely incinerated me when I found out that he was Uncle Ruckus on the Boondocks. The first season of Malcolm in the Middle is still as endearing as when it originally premiered, and I'm so happy to say that this show does nothing but capitalize on that energy moving forward. Now, this is going to sound a little weird, but bear with me. Season 2 of this show is absolutely phenomenal, but I can't necessarily say that anything here got progressively better than the first season. Now, that isn't my way of saying that season 2 was worse than the first season of the show. This is my way of saying that Unlike most television shows, Malcolm in the Middle nails its introductory season so perfectly that there aren't really any glaring issues that need to be ironed out going forward. All the amazing qualities are still here, except that now they're moving outwards and expanding. There are so many classic episodes here, it's almost difficult to fathom, but I'll start with Halloween approximately. Francis returns home for a late Halloween visit, and the brothers band together to build a super slingshot capable of terrorizing people in other neighborhoods.
My favorite line from that was, "Look out, world, violence just got a little more random."
This episode showcases quite a few things that are executed perfectly throughout the series. One being the brothers' penchant for destruction and how that always kind of seems to bring them together. These kids are monsters, but on the flip side of that, we begin to see a common trend that usually happens when these boys get into these shenanigans. They rarely ever win. Sure, they get away with terrorizing some neighbors, but by episode's end, they get pinned down on their roof by the Krellboins, who have in turn also built their own super weapon. I love this.
Krellboins just
never work. No, they call them that. Their Krellboins are the nerds, but they call them that. The closest explanation I could find as to why they're actually called Krellboin is that was the last name of the guy in what was it? Little Shop of Horrors, I think.
Oh.
Like the dork scientist guy.
Okay.
That is the literally only answer I could find is why they were called Krellboins. Look, the boys are awful most of the time, both to each other and to everyone around them. That's what makes their dynamics such a treat to watch. However, if they always won, it'd be hard to root for them because then they'd just be a bunch of jerks that go around making people miserable all the time. And most importantly, with no comeuppance. I love this balance of they do bad, but then get punished. And the series is super consistent with this throughout the run. Another absolute classic this season is Lois's birthday, which showcases the other dynamic of the boys that I really, really enjoy. And that's when they turn their destruction outwards and redirect their anger in order to stand with unity with their family. After spending Lois's birthday money on gifts for themselves, Lois takes off, angered and hurt, to clobber a batting cage. The often forgetful Hal is in the same boat as the rest of the boys on this one, and the family joins together to go apologize to Lois. Lois has a hard time accepting the apology, until a party clown insults her and a full-on brawl erupts between Hal, the boys, and a troop of party clowns.
He called her Wide Ride.
Did you just call my wife Wide Ride? It is absolutely epic. This is another aspect that Malcolm in the Middle nails. This show can smartly deliver a lesson without getting hokey with it. And that works to perfection because we know these characters and how they think so well at this point. The conversation that Lois has with her family when they try to apologize is delivered so authentically, so vividly, that it echoes every middle-aged mother in America. This is a conversation, I kid you not, that every mother and wife has had with their husband and children. Hell, I've heard this same speech from my mom a dozen times when me and my brothers were younger. If it's all so simple, then why do I need to ask? Do yourself a favor and look this scene up. It's incredible. The cherry on top is that this episode doesn't end with a cheesy fade out or I love yous thrown around between everybody. It ends with a clown beatdown, and that is a sentence I can only apply to this show. Dinner Out introduced the circle game to me and my brothers, so I hate and love this episode. Convention had me trying to wish Patty into existence on the daily, and surgery made me absolutely petrified of hospitals. And now let's talk about the grandparents, because in a show full of excellent characters, we get one of, if not the best, thanks to Cloris Leachman. Cloris Leachman as Grandma Ida is not just one of my favorite Malcolm in the Middle performances, but is hands down one of my personal favorite performances of all time. Robert Loggia as Grandpa Victor is fantastic as well, but unfortunately, this is his sole appearance. Ida is so disgustingly mean-spirited and cruel that she makes Lois look like a saint. Yet every single line of dialogue out of her mouth is gold, and I am so glad she stuck around. Krellboin Girl introduces us to Cynthia, lovingly portrayed by Tania Raymonde, who I really wish was able to become a series regular. Her contrast with Malcolm, Cynthia being equally as dorky, but lovable and outgoing, as opposed to Malcolm's more pessimistic and condescending approach, really, really worked well when they bounced off each other. Old Mrs. Old, New Neighbors, Bowling, Carnival. This season has more standout episodes than most shows can accomplish in a series. It's absolutely nuts. I want to point to two more episodes in particular before we move on. Reese Cooks and Robbery. Both have very simple quirks that I especially enjoy, and this adds to Malcolm in the Middle's simplicity as a series, while highlighting its attention to detail. In Reese Cooks, Reese learns to tame lions. Alright, look, I know it's right there in the name, but I really, really love that they add this to Reese's character. Cooking is a skill necessary to survival, but also more nurturing and motherly in nature. So attaching this quality to a character who's described as a brutal thug on more than one occasion was a really fun move, and it's something that they do keep pretty consistent with throughout the series. Robbery actually centers around a detail focused on Craig's character, in that he and Lois actually talk about the unrequited love that Craig has for her. Craig has kept it creepy but pretty secret all this time, much like the season 2 episode Into the Bunker from Gravity Falls. Wow, I didn't think I'd be making that comparison here. I really enjoy that these feelings are dragged out into the open and, for the most part, given an air of finality. Though Lois is definitely a lot more savage about it than Wendy. Even the show's bottle episodes are a lot of fun, and we kept the season off with a magnificent clip show. Any expectations for the show to lose steam here are immediately defied. I've seen this series more times than I can count, and I'm seriously dumbfounded that it manages to just stay this good. Emancipation unfortunately ends Francis's run at military school, which is admittedly my favorite backdrop for him, but takes him en route to Alaska. Emancipation also introduces Chris Eggman as Mr. Herkaby, and my god, this is how you make all your central characters being work, by introducing a character who's a bigger so we can still root for them. Even on this most rewatch, Herkaby had me seething with anger still. He's so hateable, but that is a great sign of a perfectly written character. I did enjoy Catherine Lloyd Burns in the role of Caroline Miller as Malcolm's teacher. Her more naive, open shoulder to cry on attitude was a fun contrast with Malcolm and Lois. But Herkaby is more fun to watch simply because you're actively rooting against the guy every single time. There is not any situation where you're rooting for Mr. Herkaby.
You reminded me of the teacher guy from Fairly Odd Parents.
Oh, Crocker?
Yeah.
That's funny, actually, I can see that. Poker introduces us to Abe's friends, and they are all absolutely delightful. Dan Martin as Malik, Edward James Gage as Brian, Alex Morris as Trey, and Jonathan Craig Williams as Steve. This troupe of actors are comedy gold. This series was so phenomenal at picking giant actors for smaller roles. Christmas is an easy top 10 best episode contender, in no small part thanks to Cloris Leachman reprising her role as Ida. I was cry laughing almost every single time she spoke, and this is probably my favorite Ida episode. A much overlooked character is Francis's friend Richie, who's not a huge presence in the show, but gets some good laughs every single time, thanks to Todd Gabenheim's excellent delivery. None more so than this season's Reese's job. Which, I think one of my favorite lines from him in that one is when, I forget the kid's name, the one Herkaby finds, like the little kid who's like super smart, that he has tutor Malcolm. Do you remember that one or no?
I do, but I don't remember the kid's name.
Either way, Malcolm and Reese bring him over to Richie's house.
Oh yeah.
Remember to find the evidence, because Richie blames Reese for stealing. And he's like, he says something to the effect of like, oh, hey, Dewey. And they're like, that's not Dewey. And he's like, then why have you had me call him Dewey all these years? Then when he proves that Richie couldn't have been there to steal it, he's just like, way to go, Dewey. Dewey's dog showcases the rare scenario where Dewey is in full control of his brothers. And Eric Per Sullivan does a fantastic job in helping you share with his exasperation for Malcolm and Reese. I just wish poor Craig didn't have to suffer. Poker number 2 has one of my favorite gags in the entire series, when the police are interrogating Stevie and Abe at the end. And Hal's birthday introduces us to another fantastic character Piyama, Francis's psychotic wife, portrayed by Emmy Coligado. Piyama and Lois's rivalry being one of the best of the series. Now, I have one final note on Francis arriving in Alaska. I do ultimately like Marlin Academy the best of anywhere he winds up, but Alaska is a lot of fun, and I don't see many people commenting on that. Brenda Whale as his boss Lavernia is an absolute savage, resembling more of a dictator than a boss. The episode Health Scare sets Francis and Lavernia up for a bare-knuckle brawl, and this episode puts on display something I feel was fairly underrated in Alaska, and that's the subtle humor. Alaska doesn't have as much belly laughs as Marlin Academy did, but there were so many little subtle details that were freaking hilarious. During an argument, Lavernia refers to Francis as college boy, to which Francis replies, "For your information, I'm a high school dropout." For the rest of the season, you will hear other loggers and random background characters referring to Francis as college boy. That's a really underrated joke. Francis tries to call off the fight, and Lavernia mistakes his fake compliments as Francis hitting on her. When they fight near the episode's end, a random logger interjects and shouts, "Take it easy on him, Lavernia, his only crime was loving you." There's funny stuff going on in Alaska. At the season's end though, Francis does leave Alaska as the logging camp shuts down, and he heads out to my second favorite location that he winds up in. There's not much more that I could say about the season that hasn't already been said. The characters keep growing and more qualities are added to expand or contrast their core personality traits in excellent fashion. All the new characters introduced are an absolute slam dunk. The humor is spot on, and stronger themes start weaving themselves into the already established framework to really cement this show as an all-time classic. Season 4 is the first season of the show where the episodes, while great, aren't of the same quality as all of the previous seasons. But in my opinion, the episodes of Season 4 have more to say. The premiere episode, Zoo, sees Malcolm struggling with depression while Dewey stays by his side the entire time, assuring him that everything is gonna be alright. Thematically, it's a little bit of a heavier episode than anything we've seen before it. Francis also starts to mature, landing a job at a dude ranch owned by Otto and Gretchen, portrayed magnificently by Kenneth Mars and Megan Fay. I loved any look into their world, and they led to a lot of huge laughs, especially Otto. Humilathon sees Malcolm's high school career off to an extremely rough start as Lois begins to volunteer around the school, and much to Malcolm's horror, Mr. Herkaby has found himself employed at said school. Though I'll be honest, I was happy to see him return. Family Reunion is another top 10 favorite episode. While we've seen Lois's family dynamic and learned about her upbringing so far, we finally gain some insight into Hal's, learning that pretty much his entire family despises Lois. Receiving this inside look into the parents' family dynamics allows us to understand why they treat their own boys the way that they do, showing that the cycle never really got broken and the boys will more than likely wind up treating their own kids this way someday too. We get another beautiful example of the boys turning their destruction outwards in order to defend their family, and we even see the beginning of an effort on Lois's part to treat Piyama a little better than she has been. This really puts a cherry on top of the contempt breeds contempt cycle that Hal and Lois's families passed on and through them, with Lois's gesture, albeit small, to start putting cracks in the cycle, if not break it completely. Boys at the Ranch is another fantastic episode, detailing the previous maturity I'd spoken of with Francis, while also detailing that his wild side hasn't quite died out yet. And then we get to Grandma Sue's, which gives us the dramatic revelation that Lois is pregnant yet again. The initial reaction of rage from the boys is funny enough on its own, but to cap it, then circle back around with them throwing their full support behind their mother, Francis even offering to send home some money on a weekly basis to help out, is surprisingly wholesome, and in my opinion, one of the show's more heartfelt moments. The aforementioned If Boys Were Girls is another great episode, with Francis's cameo having me in stitches every single time. That episode was what?
That episode was hot.
No comment. The two-part episode Baby, for me, is a gargantuan home run. Malcolm in the Middle is no stranger to two-part episodes. No stranger to good two-part episodes, I should add. But this episode is so frantic and hectic, it literally makes me anxious every single time I watch it. Even though I know everything's gonna work out. Abe's friends all make a return, as well as Piyama and Ida. And the pair of episodes is full of some of the most heartwarming moments, as well as one of the biggest laughs this series has to offer. That being when Lois, Francis, and Piyama concoct a plan to eject Ida from their home while Lois has the baby. Generally, I'm not really a big fan of a show adding a baby. Usually it reeks of laziness and tells me that your idea well has dried up. Looking at you, babies, who were literally only good in your debut appearances. This doesn't happen with Jamie, the fifth brother, thank God. Admittedly, Jamie doesn't add a whole bunch to the show, but he doesn't bog it down either. And he has a surprisingly fun dynamic with Reese, showing that even as an infant, he's pretty much outsmarted him already. And one more quick shout out to Stupid Girl and Forbidden Girlfriend, both excellent episodes that start exploring Malcolm and Reese's love life. This is why I adore this show so much. Every single minor issue I had with season 4, Malcolm in the Middle double back and fixes even though it didn't have to. Not only do the episodes shoot right back up to the quality you've come to expect of this series at this point, but it retains the heavier moments from season 4. Expanding on them, and leading to some pretty intense themes about family, love, and loyalty. Watching the baby is a perfect example of this because the episode's hilarious, but it keeps the heart intact. Three hot girls arrive at Malcolm's house offering to take himself, Stevie, and Reese on a limo ride to make out with them in front of their boyfriends in an attempt to make those boyfriends jealous, leaving Dewey alone at home with Jamie. Now, it's established fairly quickly that these girls are only using the boys because they're the biggest losers they could find, but Reese doesn't mind. He gives a pretty heartfelt speech to Malcolm and Stevie about why he's willing to do this, even after being insulted, and even after being told that that girl's boyfriend is gonna kick his ass. When the moment finally comes, Reese bails out of it because he finds Jamie's pacifier in his pocket, and says they have to get home ASAP because Jamie will never be able to fall asleep without it. These are the types of sweet and wholesome moments this show expertly pulls off without straying out of character or sounding too cheesy or melodramatic, which honestly you would think wouldn't work with characters like this. The writers, however, do a great job of giving them just enough heart, so none of this ever comes off as cliche. Thanksgiving is another classic episode that not only shows off Reese being an excellent chef, but masterfully dealing with real adolescent issues. These kids aren't kids anymore, and dating and high school and sex is all part of their daily lives now. After Malcolm refuses to have sex with a girl he's attracted to because she's too drunk, he polishes off his own beer and heads home to hilariously and disgustingly ruin Thanksgiving dinner. In a heartfelt conversation with Francis, Malcolm expresses his fear that he blew a shot with a girl he really liked, and Francis sets him straight. This never once feels like some lame after-school special. Consent and being too drunk to have sex are presented here without botching the subject like I've seen a lot of lesser shows do. This feels authentic, and Malcolm being drunk amplifies that, instead of disabling that morale and turning it into a lesson about underage drinking. We know he's not supposed to do that. Malcolm knows he's not supposed to do that. And thanks to the amazing character work, we know Lois is the type of mother who would never allow that. So the show doesn't need to spend unnecessary time focused on the underage drinking aspect of it and actually allow the real moral to shine through. Malcolm Films Reese is a super underrated episode when it comes to plots that actually teach our characters something and brings them closer together. They aren't and were never loving and caring brothers that always got along. So when one of them selfishly ruins it when they finally start to become closer, it hits a lot harder. Fueled by Mr. Herkaby being an absolute prick, Malcolm secretly films Reese and regretfully exposes all of his darkest secrets to all of their classmates, ruining that closeness they had begun to form. A lesser show would have a mopey third act where the characters apologize to each other and promise that they're still gonna be friends. Instead, Malcolm breaks into the school's permanent records and spills the dirt on every single kid in school, himself included. All facts which Reese gleefully commits to memory. Block Party and Christmas Trees are stone-cold classics ripped right out of the backbone of the earlier seasons, and Malcolm Dates a Family is another top 10 pick for me. Lois's Sister is another fantastic episode and introduces us to Aunt Susan, played by Laurie Metcalf, who used to date Hal, leading to some of the funniest interactions this show has to offer. Susan's doctor calls and mistakes Lois for her, revealing some horrible news in the process. The ending speech here between Lois and Susan is absolutely gripping and showcases just how far we'll go to help the ones we love, even if they don't want us to do it.
It was also the sister on Roseanne.
Was she?
Yeah.
Dewey's special class sees the revelation that Dewey may also be a genius. An idea the series plays with a little later on with a really, really fresh take on it, and a unique way to contrast it with the type of genius that Malcolm is. Malcolm takes the test for him, assuring Dewey that he won't let him be a Krellboyne, but botches it a little too well, and Dewey winds up in the emotionally disturbed class. After the truth is revealed, Dewey decides to stay in the class in order to stay back and help the friends he's made and the kids who might need his help. Displaying, for what I think is really the first time, some major selflessness from one of the brothers. I love that Dewey gets to shine from this point on, as Eric Per Sullivan is a fantastic character, and Dewey was kind of overshadowed by Malcolm and Reese's characters. Fun fact, this episode was originally going to end with Dewey revealing the news to Lois that Malcolm had taken the test for him and botched it. But instead of ending like it currently does, with a look of horrific rage on Lois's face and a pan out before you find out what the punishment was, there was originally supposed to be a screen wipe after Dewey spills the news with Malcolm standing in full uniform in the same military school that Francis got sent to. As hilarious as that would have been, the writers didn't want to sacrifice continuity for a great gag, so kudos to them. Reese joins the army is another hilarious, an anxiety-inducing multi-parter that ends season 5 and goes all the way to the first episode of season 6, which sees Lois flying off the deep end, Hal facing down life in prison, and Reese catching his girlfriend cheating on him with Malcolm. Probably one of the heaviest emotional themes we've dealt with so far. Reese eventually gets bought back from the army in the most hilarious and logical way that this show can offer, and this little mini-arc concludes with what might be one of my favorite moments between the core three brothers. There's funny stuff going on in the background, but the foreground is heartfelt and authentic, lending itself to everything we know and love about these characters without ever reaching over the top. The last two seasons are considered weaker than the rest of the series, which I guess I couldn't fault somebody for thinking. But I truly believe that there are still some big standout moments. Busey's Runaway and Standee are loaded with fantastic and true-to-character jokes. Standee especially. When Hal, Abe, and the rest of Abe's friends stand around debating the eponymous Standee in question, it leads to a hilarious, but also poignant and thought-provoking dialogue on racial issues and stereotypes. Ida's Dance is not only a fantastic Ida episode, but a great Dewey episode as well. Dewey discovers that he's a musical genius, something which I absolutely adored.
I did not like that story arc at all.
I loved it. I thought, well, I'll explain in a second why I thought it, why I liked it.
Well, personally, I didn't like how snobby he was about it.
I love that. That's, you're listing everything I really liked about it.
Really?
Yeah.
It turned him into
good. It's the brothers' whole shtick, but only Reese and Malcolm
and
got to be
assholes.
Huh?
The one good thing to come out of that was the music, the marriage bet. That was the one
that was awesome.
That came out of it.
It was originally written for that episode.
I love that.
Yeah, that was great.
Everything else about it, I don't like him being into classical. I don't like how he was so snobby about it.
I enjoyed all that about it. I liked that because he had never been that, and it was good to finally see him kind of be for once.
I do like that. I just, for some reason, I just don't like it was music.
I adore it, as I'll get into. I love that.
Okay.
When the revelation that Dewey might also be a genius was initially presented, I was a little skeptical. It would have felt cheap to make him a book-smart genius like Malcolm, as we've never seen any evidence to point to that fact. But to make him a genius on music, something Malcolm can't fathom in any capacity, was not only a great way to highlight a unique talent of Dewey's, but also to capitalize on the fact that Eric Per Sullivan is a gifted piano player in real life as well. I like the turn of Dewey being a genius based around music. It's something that some people actually do have a difficult time comprehending in real life. It's something that's just background noise to a lot of people. But to give him a music ability, something you can't really concretely explain in words as to why someone may latch onto it, and also really to give him the only thing that you can't really learn from a book. If they had given him anything else, it would kind of battle with Malcolm, as Malcolm is a genius in almost every field. He's a science, literature, almost everything. Music is something that can't really be learned from a book. Theory of it can be taught, but you can't learn to appreciate what you're hearing by reading a book. And that's why I like them giving Dewey music. See, that's why.
Okay.
Billboard is another relevant episode that brings the laughs through a ridiculous scenario, and features one of my favorite Reese lines when he, Malcolm, and Dewey are caught on top of the billboard by Lois. "Damn, she saw us! Why do billboards have to be so visible?" Billboard really tackles the issue of sexism and reminds me of the season 3 episode Cynthia's Back, which I purposely avoided talking about until now. Both episodes focus on Reese, true to character, being a sexist pig and saying quote-unquote politically incorrect things because, I mean, that's the point. In the Cynthia episode, his plans get revealed and she beats him so bad he has to eat through a straw. Years later, when the series tries to tackle similar subject matter, Reese is still an immature pig, but this time he actually learns something and delivers an ending speech so powerful it even convinces Lois that he's learned something. I hear detractors say that these episodes aged poorly, but I 100% disagree. Not only are these episodes still relevant and important to conversations surrounding this topic today, but in both episodes, Reese doesn't get away with it. To present a character as a piece of crap with no ramifications to their actions is tone deaf and moronic. To present a character as a piece of crap and have consequences for his actions is great writing. The character has to go to that extreme to hammer home that what they're saying, doing, and thinking is wrong. And that's what happens here. None of the surrounding characters agree with Reese. None are promoting his train of thought, and everyone assures him that he's a pig, leaving him on his own to learn a lesson, which he does. The first example in Cynthia's Bag played to more of a comedic effect, while in Billboard, the lesson has a more consequential outcome. One small nitpick I do have is that Francis is largely absent from these last two seasons, and his job at the ranch is seemingly dropped at random. This was due to Masterson wanting to assume a more behind-the-camera role as a director, but still wanting to appear on screen, albeit in a more of a reduced role. Francis's appearances are still more than welcome, but the show never properly addresses why he left the ranch job, only highlighting that reason in one stupid, lazy, throwaway line in the last episode of the series. That being said, this season still has greatness sprinkled all throughout, striking a good balance between the less entertaining episodes and episodes that wholeheartedly remind you of why this show is such a titan amongst its peers. Ida's Dance and Ida Loses a Leg are two of my favorite Ida episodes, and Chad's Sleepover, Tiki Lounge, and No Motorcycles are quintessential Malcolm in the Middle. I've definitely been talking long enough in this video, but here we are at the endgame.
We're in the endgame now.
Season 7 is by no means the best season of the show, and it's probably at the lower end of the scale when you stack them all up, but the heart, characters, wit, and genuine soul of this great show still shine through brightly in my opinion. This season opens with a three-banger of great episodes, including Burning Man, Health Insurance, and Reese vs. Stevie, all containing the classic essence of Malcolm in the Middle while keeping up with the more modern formatting. Army Buddy is a great Reese episode with as much genuine laughs as anything found in the earlier seasons. and Malcolm defends Reese, finally serves up some much-needed justice for the torture Mr. Huckabee has inflicted on the boys in the past. Lois Strikes Back and Bride of Ida are such deviously twisted episodes, and I genuinely feel that they offer up some of Cax Marek's and Cloris Leachman's best performances across the show. Through all the shenanigans and violence, and fights and laughs and insanity, and just all of these great qualities that make Malcolm in the Middle such a treasure to me, we arrive at the series finale, Graduation. This is by no means a perfect finale, but I've heard it referred to as only suitable. And not surprisingly, I just have to disagree with that. This is more than suitable. Malcolm and Reese are gearing up for graduation, and all the important players came back for one final show. Ida, Abe, Stevie, Craig, Francis, and Piyama are all here to play, and they are all bringing their A-game. Every single actor here is killing it. Reese is preparing to move in with Craig, and God, that's such a great dynamic, and has secured a job as a janitor at his old high school. Fearing the union will give him the boot after his training period, he and Ida concoct a mess so big that they'll have to keep Reese on after the initial probation period. Malcolm and Lois are at odds over Malcolm taking a high-paying job here and now, or going to college and furthering continue his education. Which leads to what very well may be my favorite performance from Lois in the entire series, with her end speech about why Malcolm needs to finish his education. Everyone attends the ceremony, and in the only truly lazy thing I feel like this show has ever done, Francis is revealed to have been fired from the ranch via a really stupid and cheap one-liner, but now holds a stable office job. It was so stupid, do you remember the reason?
I don't remember the exact wording, but he was depositing the rent checks into the wrong account. I'm not sure if it meant he was embezzling it into his own account.
It was so dumb. Like, he turns to Hal and says he was dropping it in like a fake ATM or like somebody. The way he describes it, it makes it sound like he was dropping it into like somebody dressed as an ATM or something. And it's so stupid, and it's so like anti-Otto. Like, I feel like nothing about Otto's character tells me that he would fire him for that.
Right.
So that's why I always found it so dumb. And I don't know what happened. I know Kenneth Mars died, but I don't think it was while the series was still filming.
Actually, it might have been. That's why they may have ended that arc just quietly. Like, we'll think of a reason later.
Yeah, but like, even if I hate, like, it just should have been something else. That's not in Otto's character to fire him for that. It's really not.
No.
Malcolm delivers his graduation speech, and in an ending montage, we see Dewey and Jamie hiding from an enraged Lois.
Wait, do we ever find out what his last name is?
Nope. The microphone statics out as he says it. Continuing the tradition of driving their mother crazy while Hal relaxes in bed, exclaiming to Lois that he doesn't know how she did it, but everything worked out exactly like it was supposed to. A horrified Lois, providing one of Cax Marek's funniest facial expressions in the series, holds up a positive pregnancy test as Bryan Cranston lets loose one of the best Hal screams. Reese has been kept on as janitor after setting his boss up as a peeping Tom Patsy, and wishes Malcolm luck via payphone as it's revealed that Malcolm has gone on to Harvard and has also become a janitor in between classes to help pay for it. Malcolm in the Middle holds an extremely, extremely special place in my heart. I don't think a show will ever nail the sibling dynamic as well as Malcolm in the Middle did. Nor do I think there's ever been, or will ever be, a more perfect and true-to-tone characterization of a dysfunctional middle-class family. The show oozes authenticity, and that's why this finale works so well, in my opinion. It's not over the top, it's not flashy, it's simple. Just like the series. The finale opts to focus on the more important subjects. The family, and how their daily lives will continue after a couple of their own have left the nest. The emotion is here, without ever feeling sappy. The characters remain true to themselves for the entire run, only changing when a new aspect of themselves is discovered, as it fits right in with the pre-established notions of the character. Without ever really feeling like it was just insufferably thrown in at the last minute. The cast is a magnificent powerhouse of performers, and everything about this show flows with a charm and a relatability that I've never seen. Linwood Boomer, I thank you, as I will truly forever be in your debt for bringing a show like this to fruition. Life is unfair, but when you come across something as special as Malcolm in the Middle, it can make the negatives of life just a little fairer. And that was it, everybody. That was my retrospective, my look back on one of my favorite shows of all time. That was Malcolm in the Middle. In the debate of the best sitcom of all time, I see it makes some top whatever lists, some top 50s, some top 20s, but I rarely ever see it put up on top, and I really do think it deserves that. And hey, if you disagree with me, unleash in the comments and let me know some of your favorites. Let me know what you'd like me to take a look at next. I think this is the first live action thing I've ever done. They're usually cartoons, but I have forever wanted to talk about Malcolm in the Middle and just never had an opportunity until we started this channel. So for Zeitgeist OG, I've been Fat Man, and if you don't think Malcolm in the Middle is the best sitcom of all time,
well, good for you, you're wrong.
We'll catch you guys next time. Cheers.
Alright, now do Third Rock from the Sun.
Alright, well, for the 2.5 episodes of Third Rock from the Sun that I've seen... Sure, they get away with terrorizing some neighbors, but at the episode's end, they that's all, folks. Crowd Boy and Girl introduces us to Cynthia, lovingly portrayed by Tania Raymonde. At this point, I'm getting a little self-conscious about it. Can you check the footage and make sure I don't look like a sweaty, disgusting mess up to this point so far? Which is, admittedly, my favorite bread. Cooking is a skill necessary to serve. Cooking is a skill necessary to just... Why can't I say that? Cooking is a skill necessary to survival. So, dude, what the f- survival? Why can't I say survive? Craig has kept it creepy, but pretty secret. I'm distracted by beer.
Would you like the beer?
Yeah. I'll take one. Thank you.
There's only one more of those left.
Old Mrs. Old, New Neighbors, Carnival, the episode that I forgot that was listed on here that I just read.